like, what the hell? I know. Okay, so today we need to get down to business. I will give opportunity for one question on homework, and that's it, because we need to get moving here. The word problem?
Yes.
Number four.
$15,000 invested?
Yes.
Okay. All right, so you have $15,000. It's number four in the homework, page 94. $15,000 is invested at an annual interest rate of 3.5% compounded continuously. So you're thinking shampoo now? Find the total amount in the account at the end of 6 years. So what was the problem you had here?
I wasn't doing the same number.
Oh, well, maybe it's wrong in the key.
You think so?
Could be. Oh, yeah, that thing's full of errors. Okay, A equals PE to the RT is what we're working with here. And so the amount that'll be in the account will be 15,000. And then E to the R, did you convert it to 0.035? Yes, and then T, you put 6.
Yes.
Okay, then yeah, that should be right. Let's see what we get. All right, 15. I'm just going to type it all in at one time. Was anybody having any trouble typing it in? No. 18,505 with some change. What did the solution say?
Like 24,000.
24,000?
That's a big number.
Hmm. Okay. Well, that is the correct answer.
Okay. Maybe the number, didn't the packet change?
They've been doing updates on that for like 3 years, yeah. And all the errors have still not been found. All right. Okay. Let's continue with material. Remember, today we're going to continue through the packet, and then on Wednesday we'll continue. Right? And I move the exam till next Monday, and then next Wednesday we review for the final, and then we have our final on
the 8th.
So that's Monday, or?
It's Monday.
Okay. And then we don't have class that Wednesday. Once final's done, we're done. All right. So we have seen already this very special function, e to the x, which was called the natural exponential function, right? And we actually started to set up what the graph of that would look like last class. But now we're going to introduce a new function. Which is called a logarithmic function. Now there's a whole classification of these logarithmic functions. Like, there's a big group of them. Just like exponential functions, remember we could have like 2 to the x or 5 to the x, right? This number could be a bunch of different things, right? Well, with logarithmic functions, you can have a bunch of different ones, but we're only going to look at one specific one. Actually, we're going to do log 10. Yeah, we're going to look at two of them, sorry. So the first, let me put new functions, plural. The first one is called the natural log. Okay, the natural log. And here's what the function is. F of x equals ln x. Now we looked at this last class, we used it, but I hadn't really introduced it to you, right? Right? Okay. So what I'd like for us to do is try and draw this function. All right, we're going to try and sketch it. We're going to need our calculator to do this. And then I'll make a connection. I'm going to connect these two together, but let's draw it first. So I'm going to make a chart here. And then we're going to go and try and plug in some numbers. So what numbers did I say for us to plug into this one? Do you remember for exponentials what I told you we should use? Remember, make a t-table? I said negative 3, negative 2, negative 1, 0, 1, 2, and 3, right? Isn't that what I said?
Yeah.
Okay, so on our calculators, let's find that natural log key. Let's plug negative 3 in. Y'all understand what I'm doing? I'm just making a chart. So you go natural log, put in negative 3, and what do you get?
Domain error.
Okay, try negative 2. Error again. How about negative 1? Error again. What the heck's wrong with this function? You can't do negatives, even if you put 0 in, right?
Yeah.
You get an error. All right? Now, 1 works. Natural log of 1 is 0. Natural log of 2. 0.69 something? 693, 14, 15, something like that? Natural log 3? 1.09? And we can keep going with this, right?
You don't have to put another,
Wait, what did you press? Because I said
that. Oh, you're using LOG.
Oh.
Not the one below it. The one below it looks like IN, but it's LN. You got it? Okay. Everyone good? No, no, you're using the natural log key. Let me see. This one right here, just press that. There you go. And then put 1 in. And then enter. It's 0. Okay? Okay, so let's try and draw this graph real quick. Just what we have so far. This is our x, this is our y, right? So this is a point. I go to the x-axis 1, and on the y-axis 0. So isn't that right here? And then when I plug in 2, I get 0.69. So if this is 1 and this is 2, 0.69 wouldn't quite make it to 1. So it'd be maybe about here. And then at 3, I would be at 1.09, which is a little bit above 1. Y'all kind of see what's happening here?
Yeah.
Just for the heck of it, put in 10. Let's see what happens at 10. See if it grew real fast or not.
No.
No, you're still at 2.3. So even way out here, right, at 10, you'd still be like only about here, right? So this thing is growing, but it's not growing very fast. It's going something like this. I'm just going to put an arrow, okay? So yeah. And we know we can't plug in anything over here, right? The graph doesn't exist because we're getting errors. That means that there is actually a domain restriction. You can never plug a negative into a log, all right? Now, let's try to plug in some numbers in between 0 and 1. How about 1/2? Try 1/2. What do you get if you plug in natural log of 1/2? You can put 0.5 if you want. You get negative 0.69. So here's negative 1. So at a half, we're at negative 0.69. Try something even closer to 1. Try 0.1. Isn't that pretty close to 0? I think I said closer to 1. I meant closer to 0. Try 0.1. What's natural log of 0.1? Negative 2, right? Negative 2.3. Try something even closer to 1, 0.01. Try natural log 0.01. Negative 4.6. What's happening? What's happening here? As I go closer to 0, this graph is going further negative, isn't it? And what we're going to have is something that we had with our rational functions. We have that thing called a vertical asymptote. See? Because I can keep plugging numbers in for the rest of my life, right? 0.001, then I could go 0.0001 until I die. I could keep doing that, and I'd keep getting numbers, right? I talk about death a lot in here, don't I? I'm sorry. Maybe we'll have a party at the end or celebrate life or something. Okay, so look, we've got this, yes? That is the graph of natural log. Now, I want you to try something kind of strange here. This is going to seem really weird, but let's try it. This was x, natural log x, both of these tables, right? Right? We plug in x into the natural log and it spit out this answer. Now what I'd like for you to do is go back to that function from last time. Let's look at the function f of x is e to the x, all right? We know we could graph this also, right? If we made a t-table for this, I told you to always plug in negative 3, negative 2, negative 1, right? All that, but I don't want you to do that. What I want you to do instead is I want you to go over here to this table, and I want you to plug this number in and see what it spits out. So take that 0 and plug it in here and tell me what you get when you plug it into the e function. So what's e to the 0? What's anything to the 0?
1.
Okay. Plug in the next number. Put 0.69315. And you're going to get about 2, right? 2. Plug in 1.09. What do you get? You're going to get something really close to 3. Y'all understand what I'm doing? If you plug in negative 0.69, what do you get? So e to the negative 0.69, you should get something close to a half. Y'all following me or not? Okay, so if I do that and I graph this together, okay, so I'm gonna put the blue graph on here. 0, 1 is here. 0.69, this is about 0.69 here. 2 is here. What's the next one? 1.093, so 1.09 and 3 is up here. And then negative 0.69 and 0.5. So negative 0.69 and 0.5, something like that. Here's our exponential graph, like this. All right? That's what I would get. So see if I can get you to wrap your head around this. Let's say we take the number 0, all right, and plug it into e. Right? What happens? 0 goes into E and it comes out as 1. Now what if I take that number 1 and I plug it into the natural log? Where's 1? Here? It goes back to 0. So if you look at it like a chain of events, 0 went into the E function, came out as 1, went into the natural log function, and came back out as 0. Y'all follow that? Let's do it for any of these numbers. How about 0.69315? Send it through E, what happens? You get 2, send that through the natural log, and you get 0.69315, right? 2 into the natural log. So what's happening when you put E and natural log together? What's happening? So it's kind of like, imagine a car going through a car wash, okay? Dirty car goes in, clean car comes out, then goes through this other car wash that puts the dirt back on the car. So it comes out, like starts dirty car, ends dirty car. Whatever this one does, this machine kind of undoes that one. Does that make sense? These are called inverse functions, all right?
Explain
that again? Okay, these two functions are completely different functions, right? Totally separate. This one, if I plug a number in like 0, it's going to spit out 1, right? If I take that answer and plug it into that function, plug 1 in over here, what does it do? Sends it back to 0, right? So you start out with 0, goes through the E function, comes out as 1, send that through the natural log function, it sends it back to 0. Yes? Send 0.69315 through the E function, comes out as 2, send it through the natural log, comes back out as 0.69315. So these two functions undo each other. They're like opposites, okay? And whenever that happens, we call these functions inverses. And that's an important property, Because at last class we were trying to do something, and I told you how to kill off E, right? I said to kill off E, you bring in this thing called natural log. That's why we bring it in. So the main idea here is that e to the x and natural log x are inverses. They undo each other. So let me see if you really get this or not. Let's say I take a number x and I send it through the e function. What's it going to come out as? Some number, right? Let's call it y, okay? And I take that number y and I send it through the natural log function. What's it going to come out as? X. That makes sense? Here's another way of writing this. Natural log of e to the x equals x. I'm going to box this. This is the most important thing. So you give me an x, right? And I take e of it. E to the x is something, right? That's some number. That's y, whatever y is. Then you take natural log of that, and it will kill off what e did, and it will just spit the x right back out. That's what we actually did last class. All right, we had e to something. I said, bring natural log in, and then whatever's up here will just drop down, right? That's the property. Also, it works this way. If I take x and I put it into the natural log first, it's going to spit out some y. And then when I send that through e, it's going to come out as what? X again. Now this one's a little harder to write, but here's another way of saying this. E to the natural log x equals x. So these are the big fundamental ideas I want you to take away. All right, let's see if you get this and give you some examples. Find e to the natural log of 5. What's e to the natural log of 5? No calculators. You don't need a calculator for this. It's just 5. Why is it 5? Because you're taking e, and what are you raising e to? It's inverse function, natural log, of 5, right? So I'm trying to get you to see like the chain of events happening here. The 5 first goes where? Into the natural log, right? And then that answer goes into e, which undoes the natural log and spits the 5 back out. Yes? Okay. What is e to the natural log of x squared? X squared. We don't have to make this more complicated than it is. All right? What is natural log of e to the 4th power? 4. Now, do you see the difference between these notations? Here, what function got the 5 first?
The natural log.
And then e got it and undid it, right? Here, what got the x squared first?
Natural log,
and then the e came in and undid it. Here, what gets the 4 first?
The e
gets it first, but then the natural log comes in and undoes it. And so you just get the 4. So what's natural log of e to the m?
M.
All right? Is that okay? I mean, these are very basic problems. Once you understand what the principle is, it's just all you're doing is identifying whatever's in the argument. What about this one? Let's actually solve some equations. So how about this? 400 equals 50 e, what the heck is that? To the 10k. And in this problem, we're solving for k, because k is the letter. All right. So, how we do this is as follows. We are trying to get 10k. We're trying to get k, right? But we're going to try and get the 10k to drop off of there, right? To drop out. That's what our goal is, to get the 10k to not be up in an exponent. We need to be down to be able to solve for it. So the way that we get things down, notice on these, notice that 4, I'm going to cover up the log for a second, but I had e to the 4, and then at some point I got the 4 to just be by itself. Here I had e to the m, and I got the m to just be by itself. But what I had to do was have a natural log, didn't I, for that to happen? I don't have any natural logs here, do I? So I'm allowed to introduce the natural log on both sides of the equation. So what you do to one, you have to do to the other. But I can't do it yet. I must first get that 50 out of there. Because I need just on this side, e to something. So how do I get 50 off that side? Divide both sides by 50. So divide by 50 here, divide by 50 here. On the right side, you're just going to get the e to the 10k, and then equals, what's that, 8? Eight. Now that you have e to something by itself, now you can bring in the natural log on both sides. So I'm going to say natural log of 8 equals natural log of e to the 10k. And what is the right side of that equation equal to? No, the right side. Just 10k. That's the whole idea right here, right? By putting the natural log in, this right here is just 10k, just like over here, right? So, but the left side of the equation, natural log of 8, you can do on your calculator. So you type in natural log 8. That's what you had said earlier, right? 2 point something? Okay. So you get 2.079. I'll just go 3 decimal places. Is equal to 10k. And finally, to get k by itself, divide by 10. So divide by 10, divide by 10, you get k is 0.2079. Make sense? Okay. Let's try another one. Let's solve five plus 3e to the 2x plus 1 equals 12. Ooh, wow. Okay, so I'm putting you into the fire right now. Now, what I want you to look at back on this problem that I still have up on the board here, what I want you to notice is that our goal, okay, was to get e to something on one side. That's when I can bring in the natural log. I can't do it before. I just have to have e, a single term here, e with just like a 1 in front of it, and then it doesn't matter what this is to, it's just as long as the e is by itself. So your first task here is to try and get that e piece by itself. So here's that e piece, right? I need to isolate that. So how would you isolate that piece? What would you do first? Subtract 5 on both sides. Let's start with that. So if I subtract 5, this is like solving a linear equation, isn't it? You're just kind of moving things around, trying to isolate something. So subtract 5, you get 3e to the 2x plus 1 equals 7. Are we to this thing yet? Not quite. That 3 is a problem, isn't it? The 3 is a problem. So how do you get rid of that 3? Divide, right? Divide. Don't subtract because it's being multiplied. So divide by 3, and you get e to the 2x plus 1 equals 7/3, which on your calculator is like 2.333333 repeated. So if you want, you can write that down. Are we to the point where we can do natural log yet? I'm going to write 2.333. It repeats, but I mean, we're just going to approximate this on our calculator anyway. So can I bring the natural log in now? Yes, because you have an e to something and it's by itself. So natural log on the left side, natural log on the right side. What does the left side become? Just, yeah, it's everything that was up here, right? The whole thing just drops down. So you get 2x plus 1. And on the right side, you're going to use your calculator to figure out natural log of 2.333, which is about 0.8471 or 72. You round, it doesn't matter. Understand? Now, solve for x, right? You need to solve for x. So how am I going to solve for x here?
Subtract
1. So take that number, subtract 1. You should get 2x equals negative 0.1528, something like that. And finally, divide by 2. X equals negative 0.0764. Okay. You get the general idea? Yeah, we divided by 2 here and divided by 2 here. Try something a little different. I want to solve something else. By the way, the two problems that I just solved, those were called exponential equations. If you look back at them, at the original equation when I wrote it on the board, they involved exponents. All right? Like the variable was up in the exponent. I want you to compare that to something like this. That's too big. Let's go 2, 3. All right, this is not an exponential equation. This was the first problem I gave us, right? This, I said, is an exponential equation because the variable we're solving for is up in the exponent. This is not an exponential equation, right? Because you don't see the variable up in an exponent. We call this a logarithmic equation because it has a logarithm. Okay? I want to know what x is. Well, how do you think you're going to get x out of the natural log? E, right? You've got to undo it, right? You've got to undo the natural log in order to get the x out of here. Right? So at this point, because natural log is by itself, I'm going to bring in e on both sides. But watch the way I do it, because it's a little, the notation's a little weird. E raised to the natural log of 2x plus 1 equals e raised to the third. So you are not going to do this. You're not writing, this is the mistake I see. E natural log 2x plus 1 equals e times 3. You're not multiplying both sides by e. That's not what you're doing. All right, this is not it. You're taking both sides and you're saying e raised to the left side must equal e raised to the right side. Make sense? Yeah. Now, what does the left side become?
2x
plus 1. Right? They undo each other. So this just becomes 2x plus 1. And then what's e cubed? Get your calculator out. Whoa. Making mistakes here. Oh. What is it? 20 what? What is it? 20.085. Okay. That's the right side. That's e cubed. And then same thing we did before, solve for x. So what are you going to do to solve for x here? Subtract 1, and then after you subtract 1, divide by 2. I'm not going to show that work. You should get 9.543 or 542 or something like that. So I subtracted 1, then divided by 2. That's a logarithmic equation. All right, let's do a word problem. Because you like them so much. Mm-hmm. All right, so all right, here's one. You invest $1,000 at a 3% interest rate. Interest compounded continuously. How long until you double your money? So you're going to go take $1,000 to the bank or wherever, and they're going to say, okay, we're going to give you 3% interest on that money. Thank you for letting us borrow it. And you're going to leave it there in the bank. And you want to know how long it's going to take to actually double your money. To go back to the bank and say, okay, I'm ready to have my money back and have $2,000, right? Let's see. Well, the formula we're going to use is what? The PERT one, right? A equals PE to the RT. What do we know here? We know A now, don't we? What's A? 2,000, because we want to double our money. We know the amount that's there at the end. What's P? The amount that we started with, 1,000. E is always E. Do we know the rate? 0.03, right, is our rate. Do we know time? No, but that isn't that what we want? We want to know how long it's going to take. And doesn't this equation look very familiar now? What type of equation is this? Exponential equation, because what we're trying to solve for is up in an exponent. So the goal here is to isolate this thing so that you can bring natural log in on both sides. So, yes? You want to double your money, right? And you're starting with 1,000, so 2,000. If this said triple your money, we would put 3,000. It said quadruple your money, we'd put 4,000. Understand? Okay, so what's my first step here? Divide both sides by 1,000. So what happens if you divide both sides by 1,000? Left side? 2, right? We're dividing both sides by 1,000. Did you subtract? Make sure you divide. Okay, 2 equals e to the 0.03t. Now?
The natural log.
So natural log 2 equals natural log of e to the 0.03t. That sounds like a little rap there.
I know.
Natural log to the e to the 0.2. 2.03t. Natural log of 2. So you just have to find any glimmer of humor in this. You have to jump on it. All right. All right. So look, 0.69314 or 315. The more decimals you go, the more accurate you are. But you know, this is just a math class. We're not engineering a building here, right? The right side is just 0.03t. Now divide by 0.03. All right. You might live to see that money. When I divide by 0.03, divide by 0.03, you get 23.1-ish is T. So approximately how long is it going to take to double your money at 3%? 23 years.
You need to find a different.
Well, 3%, that's actually very high if you're just going to leave your money in the bank. Double your money. I have a question. This is a little bit more profound, but let's see if you can make sense out of this. What if I change this from 1,000 to 1,000,000? Do you think it's going to take longer? To double your money?
Probably
the same. Longer. Let's look at the math. What would change in the math? This would become right 1,000,000 right here, but then this would become 2,000,000 here, and you would divide this side by 1,000,000, divide this side by 1,000,000, and when you divide 2,000,000 by 1,000,000, you still get 2. And so everything else is the same, isn't it?
Yeah.
So if you walk into the bank with your measly $1,000 and say, I want to double my money, it's going to take you 23 years. But if a person walks in with $1,000,000, it's going to take them the same amount of time. The difference is that they'll have $2 million and you'll have $2,000, right? That's the big difference. Understand? Yes? Okay, so it's kind of interesting that with simple interest, the amount of time it takes to double your money or triple your money or quadruple your money is totally independent of how much money you put in initially. It makes no difference. Okay, I think that's good. All right, we'll do one more of these because I think they're kind of interesting. All right, so look, some of you might have kids, some of you may not. Maybe at some point you'll be thinking about your child's future, and maybe you want to start saving up for college when they're born. I don't know. It's a good idea, maybe. All right, so what's the average cost of college tuition these days?
Lots.
To get, I mean, if you're going to get just your four-year degree, if you're going to do some postgraduate stuff, it depends, right? I think $100,000 is for 4 years. Sounds low? Let's go with the $100,000. Okay. Okay. We wish to have $100,000. Let's say your child was just born, you're planning for them to go to college when they're about 18 years old or so. So let's go within 18 years. Now in 18 years, college might be more than that. 18 years, who knows what the situation in the world's gonna be, but let's just assume everything is still cruising along, right? We wish to have $100,000 in 18 years. The bank offers 1 CD, which is not a compact disc, okay? It's called a certificate of deposit. And what that is you give them money, they give you this slip, and that slip you can take back to them to get your money back. That certificate of deposit, the catch is you can't just walk into the bank when you need the money. That certificate of deposit's gonna tell you when you can come back. So the bank is offering a CD, 18-year CD. I don't think they offer 18-year CDs. I think they're in increments of like a year, 2 years, 3 years, 10 years. But we're making this up, okay? They offer an 18-year CD, so we can put the money in, they give us a CD, and we can't go back for 18 years, all right?
What if you lose the paper in 18 years?
Well, I'm sure that they have it electronically or something. But yeah, those CDs do have value to them. I mean, that paper is important. But there's other ways, I'm sure, nowadays they can do it. So the bank offers CD 18 years at 6%. Now, I don't know if that's a good rate. I know that the shorter this is, the lower the rate. So if you go and get a one-year CD, the rate's gonna be really, really low. The longer you draw it out, the more they give you, all right? So my question, what do you think my question is? If this is a continuously compounded interest.
How much do you have to put in?
Continuous. Yeah, go ahead. How much what?
How much do you need to put in?
Yeah. How much do we need to initially put in? Right now, how much do we need to put in order to achieve this goal? So we're gonna use the shampoo formula. What do we know here? We know the amount that we want at the end, don't we? The amount that we want at the end is 100,000. P is what we put in initially, right? And we actually don't know that. That's what we want to know. And then E, do we know the rate? 6%, so 0.06. And then T, do we know the time?
18.
All right, so look, this equation is not an exponential equation. It is not. Because the variable we're trying to solve for is not up in an exponent, is it? So it's not an exponential equation. This right here is just a number. You can get your calculator out right now and figure out what that number is. So go ahead and do that. I hope it's a big number. All right, so 100,000 equals P times, I'm getting 2.94, something like that? Yes?
Yeah.
You got that?
Yeah.
Okay, so let's write it this way. 2.944P. We'll put the number in front of the letter like we normally do. And now divide both sides by that number. This might be depressing. Oof. Okay. I divided this, both sides, by 2.944. Yeah? Wow. Looks like they're not going to college. Now, I mean, $100,000, I mean, that's, I think that's reasonable these days. My goal is for my daughter to go to Texas A&M. And I think it's about 100 grand for 4 years, I think. So, get scholarships and all right, now your homework for this, we're not done, don't start packing up. Page 97. Just do all of that on 97. Now, we started out the discussion and we said that there was a very nice function that we had seen before, the natural exponential function e to the x, right? I said there was a logarithmic function that was its inverse that was natural log of x, right? I'm going to give you another example of two functions that are just like that, but not the e to the x, not the natural log. Two other ones. Let's look at the function f of x equals 10 to the x. So it's an exponential function, right? 10 to the x. If we were to graph this, would this be exponential growth or decay? Growth, because the base 10 is bigger than 1. Good. So it's going to be growth, because the 10 is bigger than 1, right? If this number is less than 1, like if it's 1 half, then it would be decay. All right? Now, is there a function that undoes this one? Just like the e to the x, had the natural log undoes the e to the x? The function that undoes this one, the inverse, is just called, not natural log, but just log x. So you have another key on your calculator, which I think you had hit before, right, on accident? That's the one you need for this one, log x. So let's see if this actually works. I would like for you to take the number 2, and I'd like for you to plug that into 10 to the x. In other words, do 10 squared, right? What's 10 squared on your calculator? 100, right? Now I'd like you to take that answer and do log of it. So what's log of 100?
2.
Are you able to get that on your calculator? And you can pretty much do this for any number. It's going to work out. Now, why do you think that this base 10 exponential function and the base 10 logarithm, why do you think that that's an important function, or why do you think it's something that we like to investigate? In other words, why not do 7 to the x and then have something that undoes that? I've given you the e to the x and the natural log undo each other. I told you those are important functions. I told you it's calculus, has to do with calculus, not to worry about it too much. But why do you think this one, 10 to the x, is very special to us? Any ideas? 10 to the x, no? No? What?
It's 10 digits.
Okay. 10 digits. What do you mean?
After 10, the number is 18. After like 11, it's only 18.
Okay, so he's saying after the first 10 numbers, the numbers repeat, like 11 is 1 and 1, and 12 is 1 and 2. You're on the right track. You're almost there. How many numbers, actual numerical numbers, are in our number system? Like digit-wise, like what are the digits? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and then 0, right? There are 10 numbers that we can use to create all numbers, right? If you give me a number to write down, 475.321, that contains digits, right? 4, 7, 5, 3, 2, 1. The only options I have for that are 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, or 9, right? Here, I can put 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, or 9. Here, 0, 1, 2, right? There's 10 numbers that we use. That's called base 10. Our number system is base 10. Why do you think we use base 10?
Because we have 10 fingers.
Because we have 10 fingers. That was obvious? Okay. No, this is actually pretty important. Because if we had 8 fingers, let's say we had 4 on each hand, we would probably use base 8 as our number system. That would be weird, right? Well, it's no more weird than base 10 would be to some alien that had 4 fingers on each hand. Does that make sense? Like, what's natural for us in counting is, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. That's what was natural to us. Does that make sense? So this base 10 logarithm is important. Our numbers are the metric system that we use. Remember we were doing conversions earlier in the semester? We had the American standard versus the metric, right? What's weird about that when we were doing the conversions is that, remember we were measuring things in like, you know, convert 3,215 feet into kilometers, right? Feet is the US standard that we use for measurement. But kilometers is what they use basically in the rest of the world. Where does this idea of foot come from?
The dude's foot.
The king's foot,
yeah.
Back in Europe. So when Americans came over from Europe, we brought the British system of measurement with us. And then the Europeans said, you know what, this system sucks, let's go to metric, because metric is base 10, everything's base 10. They all kind of got smart enough not to use some dude's foot as their measurement. They went to the common metric system, which is easy to do conversions in, and we in America stuck with what we, the system we brought over, which is kind of lame. We should switch back, but that would be hard to switch back, don't you think? Okay, so base 10 is important. What do you need to be able to do with base 10? Well, you need to first of all be able to just use your calculator. I think you can do that yourself. Let me ask you a couple of similar questions to what I asked before. What would log of 10 to the 5.2 be? 5.2, no calculator necessary, right? Right? 5.2. Now, tricky, this is going to be tricky. What's natural log of 10 to the 5.2? Very good. You have to use your calculator for this. The natural log does not undo the 10. It'll undo an e, right? But it won't undo a 10. So here you just have to get on your calculator. You would do 10 to the 5.2 first. That's going to be a big number. And then you take natural log of that. Anybody have it yet? You can type it all in at one time if you want. Anyone? 11.97? Yeah. You should get approximately 11.973. Did you use natural log? Make sure you do natural log. I'll give you another one. How about 10 to the log 4? What's that? 4. They undo each other, don't they? You're raising 10 to what? The log. The log and the 10, they undo each other, so it just spits the 4 out. Another example. Solve. 100 equals 10 to the 3x. We're going to follow the same exact method we did earlier. What type of equation is this? Exponential, because what you're trying to solve for, x is up in the exponent, right? You want to drop it down. How do we get it to drop down? Bring in the log, L-O-G, right, on both sides. Because it's base 10, I'm going to bring log in instead of natural log. And I do it on both sides. So I go log 100, log 10 to the 3x. Left side. Log of 100, 2. Right side, 3x. Everything drops out. Log and 10 kill each other. And then divide, you get 2/3. Divide both sides by 3. Get the idea? Very similar to what we did before. All right, we're going to do a word problem here. Okay, here's something from chemistry. pH equals negative log of H plus. Some of you may have seen that equation before. This is how we come up with the pH of something. pH is a measurement of like acidity or basic, how basic or acidic something is. All right? So this is the formula we use for it. Now, what most of the time gets students is the brackets and stuff there. It just makes it look all crazy. Look at what we're saying. What this equation really looks like is something like this. Y equals negative log of x. That's all that equation really is. If you give me an x, I'll just plug it into my calculator, take log of it, and make it negative, and that's what y is. Make sense? If somebody gives me y, I'm going to have to get the x out of the log. And to get the x out of the log, what do you think I would have to bring in?
Base 10.
Base 10 on both sides. So instead of e that kills off natural log, you have to bring in base 10. So let me give you the problem. In this problem, it says the pH of ammonia is 11.5. What is H plus, which is what we call the hydronium content? So they're asking for the hydronium content, which is this. All right? So let's write the equation down. We have 11.5. equals negative log of, and I'm even going to do parentheses here, H plus instead of brackets. What are we solving for? H plus. Let's get it out of the log. So we have to bring in the 10 thing on both sides, right? Yes? So I'm going to go and, now can we do this? Can we bring the 10 in now? Is the log by itself with a 1 in front? No. So how can you get the negative out of here? Divide both sides by negative 1 or multiply both sides by negative 1. So I'm going to start with that. I'm going to do negative 11.5 equals log H plus. Now come in with 10 on both sides. And when I say that, be careful because I'm not saying multiply by 10, right? It's 10 raised to the negative 11.5. equals 10 raised to the log H plus. Understand? You're raising the 10 to both sides. What is the right side? Right side. Just H plus. And what is the left side? Well, it's going to be an extremely small number. 10 raised to the negative 11.5. You should get 3.1622 and then a bunch of stuff. Then just say times 10 to the negative 12. Do y'all see that times 10 to the negative 12 there? What does that mean? That means you're going to actually take this decimal place and move it 12 places to the left. So it's like this, 3, 1, 6, 2, 2. Here's where the decimal was, right?